Holy cow. Packed house. Great to be back for I guess, my fourth year in a row here. I think 4 years ago, I think I had been N96, or at the time N86, for all of about, 4.5 days or something like that. And I was wide-eyed. It was the first time, really, I had had the opportunity to attend the symposium in quite a while, as I had been out doing some other things. But I have to tell you that in the past 3 years, this has grown to be my absolute favorite time of year. Because we get to do a bunch of things. I get to spend the time as I did today. And I have to tell you, if I stop to talk to you and it feels like I'm getting pulled away, it's probably because I got to hit the head, because I've turned 55 and, you know, I got to make sure that I take care of business. But talk about seeing friends, seeing old shipmates, seeing folk. I mean, it's just mentors, friends, the whole nine yards. And it gives us an opportunity to spend a few days concentrating on, I think, what we can all collectively agree is our favorite subject, surface warfare. It certainly is mine. And it's certainly one that I have a passion for. Certainly, and I feel very, very blessed that CNL Greenert saw fit to send me out to San Diego, because I get to spend 100% of my time. I got to spend 100% of my time as OpNav N96 working on surface warfare, and that continues today. Before I get going, I want to recognize, I want to thank the Surface Navy Association for once more, I think, raising the bar yet again. So how about a quick hand for all the folks that have put that on. And just continue to do a superb job for it every day. I'd like to thank the sponsors, as Barry did. And obviously, your support is absolutely vital in order to ensure that we continue to have this professional dialogue. I'd like to recognize a couple groups. First group, Flag Warden. Can I get the Flag Warden to stand up here real quick? And I just want to point out that these are the folks that are taking the surface warfare community into the future, okay? These and a bunch more that you'll probably see out and around. And I'd just like you to give a hand to these guys, because the support that they give to surface warfare and to me and to everybody is sincerely appreciated. So well done, folks. Thank you very much. The other group I'd like to identify, and I think they're back there in the back. Yes, they are. The midshipmen from the United States Naval Academy came down. They are the future of our Navy. They're the future of surface warfare. I am so happy that you all are here, and thanks so very much for coming down, okay? Look forward to talking to you all. The final person I'd like to recognize is Admiral Jim Doyle. I think we all know that the reason that we have the fleet today, there's a lot of people that were involved in it, but probably no one more invested and no one who cared as passionately when things were coming at us from all sides than Admiral Jim Doyle and his job as Oppo 3. So Admiral Doyle, thank you for being here today, sir, and thank you for everything you've done for our Navy. So hopped in the car with my 17-year-old son to drive across country last summer to go out and be surfed for. He said he was going to drive. If your 17-year-old son says he's going to assist you in driving across country, that's not true. I think I got a grand total of about an hour out of him. The rest of the time, it was kind of like this. But I had the opportunity to think. I mean, I obviously had taken the opportunity and had talked to a bunch of folks as I prepared to go relieve as the commander of Surf Pack and the commander of the Surface Forces. And I thought, you know, really what I wanted to do and what I wanted to understand very early in my tour and talking to a lot of folks that I admire greatly, I think I needed to build a foundation, understand where it is we need to take surface warfare. And I think what I really wanted to concentrate on first and foremost was what it is we value. So at the first Surface Warfare Officers Flag Officer Training Symposium that I held last summer, I brought the leadership of the surface warfare community in, and I asked them one question. What do we value? What do we value? Because I think that should be the foundation for where we take surface warfare into the future. Now, going back, prior to CNO Greenard's time, I was on CNO Greenard's transition team. And I was in the room with a bunch of really smart folks. And we had been assigned the task of trying to lay down some tenets for CNO Greenard. And it was a robust discussion, and at that time, we came down on certainly the first tenet, and that's warfighting first. And I said, I think we're done. Warfighting first sounds like exactly where it is we need to go. They said, now we got to come up with three. And so we came up with some supporting tenets. I think, you know, operate forward and be ready. Really, they feed into the warfighting first piece. And as I discussed with my 17-year-old son as we were driving across country, and as I thought about it, and in my moments of quiet reflection, I said to myself, really, it's all about warfighting first. It's all about warfighting first. It's all about warfighting first. So what you're looking at is the grand total of all of my slides today. And I'm going to concentrate on this. Because I think this is where we are. I think this is where we need to go. This is what needs to guide us as we press forward into the future. So, one of the products, and the other thing I thought about was I said, you know, we used to have a thing called Surface Warfare Magazine, and for budgetary reasons, it went away. It's back. Okay? There are copies here. There are copies outside. There are going to be copies in the wardroom. There are going to be copies in the chief's mess. There are going to be copies on the mess decks. We have reinstituted Surface Warfare Magazine, and I'm really, really glad that it's back. Not that I don't really enjoy reading things online, but I kind of like to hold it and bend it and move it around. And I will direct your attention to this one because this really is focused on, there's a bunch of great articles in here, but on page, I think it's 4 and 5, is the vision for surface warfare and the first principles of surface warfare. Okay? This was the foundational piece. This was the product that I was really going after in that first meeting that I had with the surface warfare officers to understand where it is we're taking the force. Something foundational. So here's where we are. And is it perfect? No, but is it pretty damn close? Yep, I think it is. Okay, and I think this will guide us as we move into the future. Another thing I did when I pressed out into San Diego was, I had spent time, obviously, writing the budget for surface warfare. And I wanted to understand if the budget that we had been executing was having the effect that we thought it was having in the 2.5 years that I was running. So, thank you very much. If anybody else would like one, I don't need more than one, really, probably. Thank you very much. Hey, how we doing? And by the way, I'm the man, train, and equip person. We are the man, train, and equip people out at Surf Pack. So, and what do you got to do? You got to go out, you got to put eyeballs on. So I went out and I put eyeballs on. I traveled up to Everett, saw the ships in Everett, went down to Vigor, saw a ship in the shipyard there. We had the opportunity to go out to Pearl Harbor, see the ships there, traveled to Sasebo. Saw our amphibious ships in Sasebo, even went down to Okinawa, saw the Peleliu down there on her final deployment. Yokosuka, obviously, went over to Yokosuka, saw the ships there. I even had the opportunity to, obviously the ships in San Diego, and had the opportunity to spend a little time with my compadre Pete Gumatautau out in Norfolk and saw some ships out in Norfolk. And what I found was this. On the manning side of the house, I am pleased with what I saw. Is it perfect? No. Are we manned to 100%? No. Are 100% of the Navy enlisted classification codes resident on the ship? No. It's not now, and it really never has been. But what I am seeing is this, and I got to tell you, I got to give a tip of the hat not only to Rear Admiral Dave Steindl, who's the Deputy Chief of Naval Personnel, but also Vice Admiral Bill Moran, an innovative thinker, a fantastic leader, and a person who is really making a difference in the distribution of our people. And so what I'm seeing is this. The trends are all positive. The ships are being manned to a higher level. The number of people that are, the training that is required of the people is at a higher level. And I'm also seeing that higher level being achieved earlier in the training cycle. And so I think it's good. The trends are good. Now, we have put a lot of energy into this to move this in the correct direction. And I think it would be foolish of us to high-five each other and to say, yep, we've slayed that dragon, let's go find another one to slay. We're going to have to continue to put energy into this. But with the great leadership of the Chief of Naval Personnel, the Deputy Chief of Naval Personnel, all the professionals that we have working personnel distribution, I think we'll continue to trend in a positive direction. I'm certainly going to pay attention to that. And I'd be remiss if I didn't say also fantastic support from Fleet Forces Command and from PAC Fleet as well. On the training side of the house, what I saw was this. I was very, very pleased with the work that we had done in OPNAV N96 to define the requirement for training and then defend that requirement in the budgetary process. The process was matured by about 3 or 4 years, and it was going very well. What I am seeing in the fleet is I am seeing the impact of that deliberate and disciplined process on our ships. I'm seeing it in the voices of the sailors. I'm seeing it in the reaction that I get when I say, hey, how's training? How are we doing? Now, have we slayed the dragon? No. Will we? No. But by golly, we're going to continue to push it as hard as we possibly can. And we're going to continue to put energy. We're going to continue to put emphasis. And we're going to continue our focus on that. So on the training side of the house, while it's not perfect, we're doing pretty darn well. Now on the equipping side. Given, again, our experience in OPNAV N96, I had the opportunity to really, at this point, kind of develop the process with a bunch of phenomenal people, not only at C-21, but at SurfMap, at RMC, working with Dave Gale and Bill Galinas, Larry Creevy, in order to understand how we define and how we engineer a requirement for the maintenance of our ships and how we then ensure that those investments are properly defended. And a tip of the hat to all the professionals that work on that, because I think they've done a superb job of moving us forward in defending that fungible asset of funding maintenance in our fleet today. And so as I proceeded west, I felt pretty good about where we were. Now, I'll tell you, when I arrived out in San Diego, I spent some time on the ships, and what I found was there was a disconnect, if you will. A disconnect between the processes that we were going through in order to determine what funding was needed and the execution piece. So in the wake of that, what I did was I said, hey, I've really got to understand this. So out in San Diego, we gathered really all of the flag officer leadership associated with maintenance and modernization of our surface ships for a two-day summit, if you will. The resource sponsors, Major General Walsh and Rear Admiral Fonta were there. Admiral Hilardis came, the fleet maintenance officers came, the CEO of RMC came. And I wanted to know, obviously, Admiral Guma Tao Tao wanted to know what the barriers were, wanted to know how we're going to knock down that barriers and how we're going to get after this execution piece. Robust discussion, a great day of conversation, a great day of really digging into and understanding why we were missing. Came up with a plan of action. Admiral Guma Tao Tao is executing that along with his partners in crime, Admiral Galinas and Admiral Creevy, with a lot of work, and a lot of help from other folks. Second day, we brought the leadership from our private yards in. Talked to them about what we had learned. Talked to them about how it's going to be different this time and how we're going to move forward. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm focused like a laser on getting to where it is we need to be with respect to the maintenance of our ships. We have to. We're transitioning to the optimized fleet response plan. We have to have a commitment to get our ships in on time, get them out on time, and get the maintenance and modernization that is needed executed. And we're going to work on that. We're going to work on that hard. So manning, training, I thought we were in pretty good shape. I think from the issue of defining the requirement and then defending that requirement, I think we're in pretty good shape. And with the great work of a lot of great people, we're going to start moving forward and getting our ships maintained and modernized properly and on time. And I think all three of these things are about warfighting first. We look at another aspect of warfighting first, and that is our relationship with the United States Marine Corps. Again, on the transition team, when I was listening to Sino Greener talk, he spoke emphatically, and he has spoke with great passion since then, that the United States Marine Corps is the number one joint warfighting partner of the United States Navy. Well, I will take that a step further. And I will tell you that the United States Marine Corps is the number one joint warfighting partner of the surface forces. Our amphibious ships, take those 2,200 Marines on board our amphibious readiness groups, and we deliver them where they need to be, when they need to be there, and we must be there for them. So it's no mistake that when I took over as the commander of surface forces back on August 7th, first three ships I visited on the San Diego waterfront were the New Orleans, the Harpers Ferry, and the Boxer. I wanted to know exactly where we were with respect to those ships, and I wanted to start to learn very rapidly what it is we need to do to make sure that we can be there for the United States Marine Corps. My first trip to the Western Pacific, I bypassed Yokosuka and I flew right into Sasebo. I wanted to see Bonhomme Richard. I wanted to see Ashland. I wanted to spend time on Peleliu to understand where we are. I had the opportunity when I was visiting Admiral Guma Tao Tao in Norfolk to go on board WASP, to see the changes that have been made in order for the embarkation of the Joint Strike Fighter on that ship. I wanted to put eyeballs on it. I wanted to understand what it is we need to do. Because as I look around the world today, and as I look into the future, what do I see? I see a tremendous capability in our amphibious readiness groups. Whatever the number of ships are, 2,200 Marines, the ACE, which includes MV-22, and in the not-too-distant future, the Joint Strike Fighter. And what I see in that is I see a lot of different options for the leadership of the country as we move forward. And I think it is the surface forces' responsibility to deliver that. And so I'm going to be focused very keenly on making sure that we are doing our part in recognizing that our joint, number one joint warfighting partner of the surface forces is the United States Marine Corps. And in my mind, that's all about warfighting first. Well, let's talk a little bit more about warfighting first and what we're doing in surface warfare. Last year at this symposium, Tom Copeman at the time mentioned that we were going to stand up an organization called the Navy Surface and Enlisted and Expeditionary Warfare Development Command. That has morphed now, and we are in the process of standing up the Naval Surface Warfighting Development Command, Warfare Development Command. We're going to stand it up under the leadership of Rear Admiral Jim Kilby. And we're working on implementation guidance that the CNO has provided to us. We're working on transition plans in order to fully instantiate the Naval Surface Warfighting Development Center. But every time I sit down and talk to Admiral Kilby, every time I think about the work that we're going to be doing in raising the level of tactical expertise in our surface forces, I get very, very excited. I think this is a tremendous, tremendous step forward for the surface forces in getting to where it is we need to be tactically and from a proficiency perspective. Now, this is not to say that we have not been working on this for a while. We have in the fleet now being produced in Dahlgren and out in San Diego, warfare tactics instructors in both anti-submarine warfare and in integrated air and missile defense. Now, this is not your fly-by-night course by any stretch of the imagination. This is a difficult, difficult course. And the feedback that I'm getting from the DESRONs, the feedback that I'm getting from the ships, the feedback that I'm getting from the fleets, is that these people are making a tremendous, tremendous impact across the board on the tactical excellence of our fleet. And we're going to continue to move this program forward. Warfare tactics instructors. Admiral Kilby has the dot on his forehead to continue to expand this into amphibious warfare, into mine warfare, into anti-surface warfare. I think this is all positive and all the direction that we need to go to get after warfighting first. Well, what else are we doing? I had the opportunity to head up to the Naval Postgraduate School. And again, you walk into a room that's got 100 lieutenants that have got just spirit and enthusiasm, and you say to yourself, holy cow. What a fantastic place. What a fantastic opportunity. So I started thinking about how we could better leverage the Naval Postgraduate School in Surface Warfare. Talked to Admiral Ellis, the undersea chair. Talked to Admiral Rick Williams, the mine warfare chair. And I started to think to myself, how can we better plug in? As I've got this Naval Surface Warfighting Development Command standing up, we certainly are going to be focused very heavily on tactical proficiency, tactical execution at the surface forces level. I said, you know what? I think the time has come to stand up the surface warfare chair at the Naval Postgraduate School. And we're going to do that. I've identified the billet. We're going to put an active duty captain, post major command, at the Naval Postgraduate School. And that is the person that's going to then bring that massive body of knowledge that are those young SWOs that are at the Naval Postgraduate School, and the linkage between the Naval Surface Warfighting Development Center, SWAS, SURF 4, SURF LANT, I think it's only positive. I've talked to Vice Admiral Rowden about it. We've got some things we've got to work through, but it is my goal that when I am standing before you 1 year from now, God willing and the creek don't rise, that I can look you in the eye and I can say, we've stood that chair up, and this is the benefit that we're seeing in surface warfare. And this is where we're going to go in the future. But I think it is a tremendous, tremendous positive step. Again, what's it all about? It's about warfighting first. Okay? Now I'd like to shift for a little bit. And I'd like to get into really the heart and soul of our symposium. talking to Dave Hart as we were working on the theme for this year. I kind of landed on distributed lethality going on the offensive. And if you have been nodding off to this point, I would ask you to please listen to what I'm going to say. Because I think that this is the start of the formulation of really where we need to take surface warfare in the future. I spent quite a bit of time working on this portion of the presentation. And so if you will indulge me, I'm going to step to my notes and I'm going to speak from my notes as opposed to extemporaneously as I have in the past. You know, surface warfare has been a lot in the news lately. You know, most recently, the Center for Strategic and Budgetary Assessment put out a report in November called Commanding the Seas, a plan to reinvigorate U.S. Navy warfare. Copy of it right here, written by Brian Clark right back there. You know, Brian, I think, is a true friend of surface warfare and a great mind as we think about this. I commend this study to you. And while I can tell you that I don't buy into every single one of the recommendations lock, stock, and barrel, there is a considerable amount of good thinking and thinking that should all get us talking about where we're going. At the heart of this report and the heart of other writings, whether it was Professor Wayne Hughes out in the Naval Postgraduate School, whether it was Admiral John Harvey, at the heart of all those things, and what I consider to be the real story that is worth focusing on today, and that is how the surface force can more effectively execute its critical role in ensuring that our country's interests are protected and sustained. There is a growing recognition that surface warfare, the face of our Navy, can and should step up. That is what I want to talk to you about today. I hope that some of you have had the opportunity to read this month's issue of the Naval Institute Proceedings. Actually, I would hope that all of you are faithful subscribers. Pete Daly, you're welcome. In that article, Pete Fonta, Pete Gumatautau, and I lay out a vision for the future of surface warfare that we call distributed lethality. And the three of us owe a debt of gratitude to the man I replaced as commander of the surface forces, Vice Admiral Tom Copen, who in his last two vision statements sounded the call for increasing force lethality. I want to spend some time talking to you about distributed lethality, why we need to move in this direction, and how the surface force will develop and implement this concept. But I think to understand where it is we need to go, we got to start by doing a little bit of a review about where we've been. The Navy that stood down the Soviets was a well-balanced force capable of sustained combat operations across the depth and breadth of naval missions. It was a Navy that was equally adept at sea control as it was at strike. And it was a Navy in which carrier strike group missions were distributed broadly among the assets available, with surface ships capable of targeting and destroying enemy ships over the horizon, prosecuting submarines scores of miles from the main body, and controlling the outer air battle in conjunction with airborne early warning and F-14 Tomcats. Keep in mind also that the land attack capability that we in surface warfare came to prize so strongly after the wall fell was originally to be integrated into the balance fleet devoted to deterring and, if necessary, fighting the Soviets. But the wall did fall. And the world was left with one dominant naval power, unchallenged at sea, and unstoppable as a power projection machine. Because no one could challenge our dominance at sea, we valued some missions higher than others. As I talked about on this stage last year, we got really good at TLAM strikes. We got really good at VBSS, at anti-piracy, because there was no real threat to our sea control. We got rid of S-3s on aircraft carriers. We stopped building ships with long-range ASUW weapons. And we moved to a paradigm where we would move the aircraft carrier off the hostile's coast, and we would generate as many strike sorties as the crew could handle. That fleet architecture, radically different than the Cold War, was a reflection of a number of factors. First, it was the recognition of reality. There really was no one who could challenge us at sea. And blindly ignoring that fact would have been a terrible suboptimization of our scarce resources. Second, the lack of a blue water foe colored the manner in which we formulated and conducted campaign analysis, the kind of analysis that revealed gaps in warfighting wholeness across the spectrum of mission areas. Simply put, our campaign analysis made assumptions that were sensible for the times, given the lack of any significant maritime threat against which to plan and the desire to reap some financial savings after our victory in the Cold War, cashing in on the peace dividend. Those assumptions included an approach to scenario planning and wargaming in which all of the elements of the force were employed together, such that aircraft carrier battle groups would operate in close proximity to surface action groups and amphibious readiness groups, which we would be mutually supported by land-based maritime patrol aircraft. While this scheme is effective in identifying gaps and seams in capabilities across the entire ensemble, it presupposes that the entire ensemble will be in place and ready to fight when the fighting starts. And since there was no real maritime foe to seek out and destroy, when the surface force wasn't supplementing the striking power of the air wing with TLAMs, it was devoted primarily to defensive operations in the vicinity of the aircraft carrier or the other high-value units. In the name of efficiency and cost savings, the surface force got out of the offensive SUW game, and the mission migrated almost exclusively to our air wing. Again, this approach makes sense in a relatively unchallenging maritime environment and when the force fights in close proximity. But the world has changed, and with it, so must our assumptions and our preconceptions. That is what we're doing in surface warfare. We are challenging our own assumptions and the assumptions of others, and rethinking our role in future naval warfare. We are adapting to a changed environment. We are responding to national strategic imperatives, and we are going on the offensive. The underlying approach to this premise is pretty simple, which is good because I work better on simple things. The surface force is going to be more lethal across all major warfare areas through distributed lethality, which has two parts, one architectural and the other operational. From the fleet architecture standpoint, distributed lethality means we're going to upgun as many existing platforms as we can to achieve more total lethality from a given size and composition. From the operational standpoint, it means taking these now more lethal ships and combining and operating them in new and novel ways, ways that threaten things the adversaries value both ashore and afloat, while simultaneously adding complexity to their surveillance and their targeting problems. When we talk about the architectural or fleet, we'll talk about the architectural or fleet design part first. Let's face it. When Secretary Hagel told us to go off and take a good, hard look at our small surface combatant program last year, he wasn't telling us to perfect cold fusion. Our history is replete with examples of steadily increasing the lethality of ships and classes throughout the lives of those ships. We added RAST in the 19 tail to the Oliver Hazard Perry class and the Spruance class. We replaced the Mark 26 launchers and the TLAM armored box launchers on our Tycos and our Spruances with the vertical launch system. We added a hangar, CEC, and BMD capability to many of our Arleigh Burke destroyers. My point is, we have never looked at a warship at commissioning as a finished product. And we don't design ship classes to a point solution. We build ships to last for decades. And we know from the beginning that new technologies will have to be integrated in order for that ship to face the threats it will face. Some instances in lethality are planned into the program from the get-go. And some have to be backfitted and integrated later in the ship's life. So moving in this direction is really second nature to us. What we're doing differently today, however, is we're looking closely at the fleet as a system and identifying where the fruit is, low-hanging or otherwise, so that we can harvest it, irrespective of ship size and type, by adding weapons and sensors. This is a smart play irrespective of the level of resourcing we receive, but especially important against the backdrop of flat defense budgets. We are actively looking around the fleet to target lethality upgrades wherever they make sense. For instance, most of you are aware that we're actively beginning a program to acquire an offensive anti-surface weapon. One that puts us back on the positive side of the range equation with respect to our potential adversaries. We need to think about this weapon as something that we can backfit throughout the DDG fleet, starting most presently with 79 and up, which were built without a long-range ASUW capability. Perhaps this weapon is, or one similar, can be both forward fit and backfit on our small surface combatants, including the LCS. But why stop there? We'll have between 30 and 33 amphibious ships in our fleet throughout the life of the current 30-year shipbuilding plan. What's to keep us from equipping these ships with an offensive SUW weapon? Now, I know, and I spoke before, that our responsibility is to deliver our Marines, our Marine Corps joint warfighting partner, where they're needed, when they're needed. But can you imagine? And we've got to look at the benefits and trade-offs associated with putting an ASUW weapon on these ships. But I think that the benefits for sea control and for sea power are significant. I think we've got to go take a look at that. I think we've got to look at the LXR before its requirements are set in stone. One that can project power through the activities of a 19-year-old infantryman, or dispatch enemies at long range. Not saying we need to do it, but I think we need to think about it. Or maybe we look at an affordable land attack weapon that fills the gap between surface fires of the advanced gun system on the 1000 and the TLAM. Why couldn't we field a 300 to 500 nautical mile missile that can be fired from existing ships, including amphibs? But again, why stop here? Why not think about putting offensive weapons on our combat logistics force ships? I realize fully there are legal implications associated with that, and I think we probably got to work at that. But I got to tell you, if you think about the logistics force, you've got to have it in order to be able to fight, and I think that they're going to be right in the enemy's wheelhouse, going right after them. Why don't we give them something more to think about rather than just taking out the log, but that log can reach out and touch them? Again, I think we got to think about it. So the picture I'm painting is one of a surface force that is bristling with offensive capability. One in which large number of ships cannot be ignored in terms of assigning surveillance and targeting assets. I realize that there are those of you who saw the recent proof of concept where we took a launcher and we bolted it on the back of a littoral combat ship and we fired it as some kind of a gimmick. And I have to say to you, I think you missed the point of the exercise pretty significantly. That experiment, that demonstration, started back in March when I went up to the Naval War College to do a war game that included a significant number of littoral combat ships. And in that war game, we played a 120-mile missile off of littoral combat ships. And what was interesting to me, and what was really eye-opening, was the response that we forced from Red in that game. I think Red had the preconceived notion that they could walk in and they didn't have to even worry about LCS. They'd kind of get to them when they got to them. That wasn't the case after I put a 120-mile missile on that ship. They had to worry about them all the time because they could do real damage to their fleet. And so when we put that launcher on the fantail of LCS and we fired it off the Southern California coast, what we were really doing is we were really closing the loop on really an early step in distributed lethality. Take an idea, war game it, see if you can do it. And we did. And so the question I have is, if we can do it on LCS, can we do it on other ships? And I think the answer is we can, and I think we should. Now that I've covered the fleet architecture aspects of distributed lethality, let me spend a little bit of time on how the concept could be employed operationally. If our Navy's going to adequately respond to the national strategic imperative to rebalance to the Asia Pacific, we're going to have to get used to the fact that we're going to have fewer number of ships and the Pacific is as big as it ever was. In order to provide our friends, partners, and allies with the insurance and deterrence that we expect and they desire, I think what we have to do is we have to think about our fleet, and it may in fact be spread more thinly across this maritime expanse. Therefore, every ship in the fleet needs to be prepared to close and engage adversaries when they're called upon and may be required to do so without the air cover that we will typically have when we're operating with a carrier strike group. The campaign analysis and assumptions that I spoke to you about earlier, I think, again, we've got to take a look at them. And this different world that we're moving into, our fleet's probably not going to be fully deployed and arrayed in a mutually supportive postures. It's going to be spread across thousands of miles of the ocean, far from the protective cover of swing-loaded Hornets. In order to target, harass, and neutralize an adversary in a large maritime theater, the surface force will operate in its critical and historic role in defense of the high-value units such as aircraft carriers, amphibious ships, and our logistics ships, but it will also be dispersed throughout the theater in what I'm referring to as hunter-killer surface action groups, netted together when those nets exist, but also capable of autonomous dispersed operations should those overarching networks break down. If we take care of the first aspect of distributed lethality, imbuing as many ships as possible with offensive punch, the second aspect, which is dispersed operations, creates multiple attack axes and a considerably more complicated targeting problem for any adversary. It will give us the ability to hold his forces ashore and at sea at risk, at distance, which is really what we're driving at, by multiplying the pure number of naval activities that he must target, we dilute both his ISR and his available weapons inventory. I urge you to take a look at the proceedings article, which was published this month. In it, I lay out a couple of, Pete and I, lay out a couple of notional surface action groups. And as I've done more thinking since we finished the article, you know, we look at not only the LCS and its instantiation today with the installed anti-submarine warfare package on board as a significant contributor to future hunter killer surface action groups, or the follow-on modified littoral combat ship that came out of the Small Surface Combatant Task Force, certainly our guided missile destroyers, whether it would be Flight 1, Flight 2, or Flight 3. But I think we have to take that further. I think we have to also think about the significant contributions that we can receive, that will be contributed to these type of formations, these type of operations by our friends, partners, and allies. I had the great good fortune of serving over in the Republic of Korea and spending some time on their guided missile destroyers. Tremendously professional fleet and a tremendously capable ship that would fit very well in this type of use. And the exact same thing with the tremendous professionals across the Sea of Japan with respect to the JMSDF or our Aussie partners or any of our friends and allies. Their ships do not routinely work with our larger ships and are much more comfortable fitting into our surface action groups. I think there's tremendous benefit here. I think we really need to go leverage that. Evolving the force to deploy distributed lethality is going to be a generational task. It will take time, effort, and resources to accomplish. It's going to take a concerted effort of the leaders in this room to make it happen. We aren't talking about missiles and sensors alone. We're talking about people, about developing a whole new generation of warfighters comfortable with detached operations and able to accept the realities of mission command and decentralized execution in a high-tempo combat environment. Critical to this effort is the work that I mentioned earlier at the Naval Surface Warfighting Development Command and the work that Admiral Jim Kilby is doing to stand that up. We are raising the science and the art of surface warfare up a notch, with the aim of producing certified tactical experts that will be closely managed and detailed to the billets where their talents will have the most impact. In the end, it will be these experts and the sailors they impact that will ensure our surface force remains ahead of all who challenge it. I'm certain that we're headed in the right direction. We've got a lot of work to do. We've got a lot of meat to hang on the bones of distributed lethality. But I think it's the direction that we have to go. I really appreciate your time and attention. Again, my gratitude to the Surface Navy Association and all the sponsors for everything that they're doing for surface warfare. And I look forward to your questions. Thank you very much. Sydney.
Sydney Friedberg, Breaking Defense, and a frequent thorn in a friendly way in the Admiral's side.
Debatable, but yes.
Yeah, I shouldn't argue with somebody who has long-range offensive weapons, maybe. Let me ask, this is a powerful vision. I've read Clark's study as well. The question is, you know, how do you get there? Because right now we have a fairly short-ranged harpoon that not all the ships can fire. Mm-hmm. We have no Tomahawk anti-ship missile. That was, the TASM was phased out, gosh, in the 90s. And modified LCS will not have a VLS cell, although it will have some kind of to-be-defined anti-surface over-the-horizon missile. Mm-hmm. Plus, before you can fire your new weapons, whatever they are, you need to actually lock on, which means a lot of electronic warfare, a lot of sensors, a lot of protection for your comms, as you said. So what are the challenges in terms of both the kinetic and the electronic armaments to get the fleet where it needs to be? And what's the timeline to get all these things actually on the water?
I think that, great question, Sydney. I think that as I'm fond of saying, it's more important to build Rome than it is to build Rome in a day. Okay? So I think the first thing that we have to do is we have to look at the weapons that currently exist, the systems that currently exist, and see what modifications that we can make to those systems to increase our offensive punch. We started to work on that when I was back as the resource sponsor. And I think we are obviously going to continue to do that under Admiral Fonta. Certainly there is work that has to be done in order to develop the analytic underpinning that says this is the direction that we're going to go, because we have to cover it with analytics. It has to make sense. And obviously, there's an aspect associated with resourcing it. And you can't ignore that, certainly in the budget that we have. What I'm saying is that we have the finest combat systems out there, and we have the finest engineers out there, and we have some pretty darn good weapons out there. And as there are things that we can do to the weapons that we have today, there are certainly things that we can do with respect to how we bring our ships together and tactically execute in order to be able to start to distribute the lethality of the force. And so I think the overarching theme is the fact that we have to distribute our lethality and not concentrate it. So as a consequence, and then look at new and different and innovative ways to take our ships that are more offensive, however we've built that into our ships, in order to be able to utilize them in a more effective fashion. I think that I am very encouraged by a lot of the rather robust and relatively low-cost options with respect to unmanned. I think we need to think hard about unmanned. I think we need to think hard about how we can take those capabilities, build an organic capability into our ship or our surface action groups to extend their range, to extend their control, and then force our adversaries and our potential adversaries to think differently about our ability to reach out and touch them from range. So specifics, I think the specifics will come. I think once we get the analytics that demonstrate, hey, this is the direction that we have to go, and I believe they will prove it out, and then drive in that direction. So, others. Wow. Becky.
Admiral, good to see you.
Yes, ma'am, good
to
see you.
So glad you're here. For those of us who've been around a few years in the Surface Navy community, we're aware of the Surface Warfare Development Group down in Norfolk and the role that they have played off and on over the years in their mission. Mm-hmm. How do you envision the Naval Warfare Development Group that you're talking about standing up or is being stood up? How do you see that mission playing with that with respect to how Surface Warfare Development Group has played, and how do you see that going forward, and what may be the differences with respect to that mission?
Right. We have to work our way through that. In other words, the Surface Warfare Development Group certainly is going to be the work that they have done in the past is going to be, I don't want to say absorbed, because that's not the right characterization. What we're looking for in the standing up of the Naval Warfighting Development Command is the ability to take the mission areas that we address in surface warfare across the multi-missions that we execute and bringing those together in a coherent fashion so that we can then raise the tactical tactical execution on our ships to a very high level, to a level that we need to raise it to, and to keep pushing it up. So, okay, Mr. Pullmar.
Admiral, this day, can you give us a couple of groups on the mine warfare situation, especially since we're truncating the LCS program, which was to be our future mine countermeasure ship, coupled with the problems with the MH-60S not being able to tow the mine countermeasures gear? Where are we in the mine countermeasures area, and is anyone really paying attention to it? Thank you, sir.
Yes, great question, Norman. I would say it is not an accurate characterization to say that I don't think we're truncating anything. The mine mission package that we are developing and that we're going to test in this summer on LCS down in the Gulf Coast is going to deliver a increased capability to hunt mines. And I think given the fact that, and so the transition as we press forward in mine warfare, and I got to say that that our MCMs that we have out there now, and had the opportunity to visit quite a few of them, they are doing pretty darn good, but we're going to sundown those ships sometime in the next decade, and we have to be able to step off into where we're going in the future in mine warfare. That future is the littoral combat ship and the package that we're putting on the littoral combat ship. And there's a couple things that I think are really significant in that. The first is we're gonna go instantiate capability in that ship this summer and we're gonna IOC it. But given the fact that we have, again, the modularity flexibility that we have built into those ships, I think that as new, again, one of the many real beauties of those ships is the fact that as new technology comes along, it will be able to be integrated into the ship in a much more cost-effective way and a much more effective way to ensure that we can continue to move forward in mine warfare. So we're going to go to the littoral combat ships as our seagoing mine warfare capability and then move into beyond hunting, into sweeping, et cetera, we'll be able to build into those ships, which is, and the helicopters will play a role, but again, it's been about 5 months since I've stepped out of N-96, and I'm not sure exactly where we are, and so I don't know, maybe either Admiral Fonta or Admiral General Walsh can address that specific aspect during their pitches. Okay. Yes, others, yes, ma'am.
Admiral Andrea Shalal with Reuters. I wanted to follow up on Sydney's question, but then also pose one of my own. You know, given the budget climate, what is your ability to move forward with these capabilities or distributed lethality that you're talking about? And how much money do you anticipate it will take? I mean, how significant of an investment is required? The missile that you fired off of LCS was built by the Norwegians. Is that something that you're realistically exploring in terms of perhaps netting together those international capabilities more? You mentioned the importance of getting allies outfitted. So I wonder if you could address those two things. Yeah. And then I wanted to ask you about the readiness of the fleet, particularly with regard to the amphibious ships. We've heard reports about readiness being poor. And, you know, partly because of sequestration and just sort of issues with ships. Are you very concerned about that? How significant is that problem? And will it lead to delays in the departure of any new forces?
Yeah, okay. Thank you. First, with respect to, obviously, as we go forward and we look at modification or the development, modification of weapons and systems that we have, or the development of additional weapons and systems. I mean, obviously, those are going to have to go through the process, the budgetary process, be defended, be validated and be executed. I think the more important piece is to look at the weapons that we have now, the sensors that we have now, the capabilities that we have now, see what modifications we might be able to be make to them. And I think that we have a tendency to kind of focus on that aspect of it. I think it's important to remember that the other significant portion of the execution of distributed lethality has to do with the tactical execution, how we think about employing our forces in new and different ways. And you know, it's perhaps if I liken it to a chess match, if I were to think about the changing execution about how we aggregate and employ our forces, really what we're looking at, I think, is we're looking at changing the rules in the middle of the game. So, for example, you're playing a game of chess, and all of a sudden I get one opportunity to say, or whatever, to change the rules, and I say, you know what, pawns can now move three. And you've been executing this strategy all the time in order to try to defeat me in the game, and all of a sudden pawns can move three, it changes your strategy completely. That's the tactical piece, I think. That's the operational piece that I think we have to get after, okay? On the readiness side of the house, I was up talking to my father this weekend, and back when I was younger, he had command of USS Columbus, CG-12, and he was operating in the Mediterranean on his final deployment. And he told me a story about he was out there operating with a destroyer, and at the time, the destroyer could only man a 2-section watch bill. And so he said, "Well, I'll just give you some watch standards, and you can operate a 3-section watch bill." That ship actually had to go anchor at night because it didn't have enough people to steam throughout the night. Okay, and I was thinking, holy cow, talk about a readiness nightmare from the standpoint of not having enough watch standards to be able to steam your ship 24 hours a day. With respect to the fleet that we have today, first of all, I can tell you that we can man a 3-section watch, but we can steam 24 hours a day. Okay, so we're probably a little bit better off than we were back in 1970, a long time ago. But I think that there are concerns about the readiness of the amphibious. For there are concerns about readiness of the ships that we have. I can tell you that we are facing those readiness challenges head on. In my opinion, from the time that I have been out at SURFPAC, they are all trending in the correct direction. I believe we have a significant number of tremendous professionals concentrating on understanding exactly what it is we need to do and how to move us in that direction. And I'm confident with the support of both Admiral Harris and Admiral Davidson of Fleet Forces and the folks that we have on the waterfront, that when we aggregate those forces and we push them up to CERDEX, that they're trained and they're confident in order to be able to go do the things that we need to do. Would we like to have this level of readiness at all times in order to be able to surge forces and do other things? I think the unfortunate reality of it is, given the budgeting that we have, we're taking some reductions in readiness. But we've got to, again, work on making sure that we got it squared away. One of the things that I'm concentrating on fairly significantly is to ensure that as we take our amphibious ships into the maintenance availabilities, we have the correct amount of time in order to be able to get them the work done and the amount of funding. And the fungible asset that seems to be tough right now is not necessarily the funding as much as it is the time. And so that's why we're working on the pre-planning piece, the planning piece, to understand in toto everything we need to do to get the readiness of our amphibious ships up to where it is they need to be. Okay? Yes, sir. Right over here. I got one more. Mark, I'll get you later, okay? All right, sir.
Sir, Lieutenant Hipple from ComNav Surfline.
Yes, Lieutenant.
Sir, you said that it is a generational issue and that it'll require sailors that are comfortable with distributed operations. What do you see with the sunset of the MCMs and the uncertain future of the PCs as the future of junior commands that'll give that kind of training and experience for folks who operate independently at sea?
Yeah, that's a great question, okay? Certainly, we're about a decade away, I think, from the MCMs, and the timeline for the PCs. Certainly, I think early command for surface warfare has always been a tremendous opportunity that really exists only in surface warfare. I think obviously we're gonna, and would I like to be able to continue to offer early command to our young men and women? Absolutely. But in the event that we go in a direction that doesn't allow that, I don't think it relieves us of the training responsibility in order to be able to imbue our surface warfare officers at the ensign and Lieutenant JG level or up through department head and beyond in understanding how to execute that. And I can tell you, I mean, I had commanded Melius. That was the ship that I commanded. But there's a guy back there standing against the wall, and there's a guy sitting right here, Vice Admiral Phil Quast, retired, Rear Admiral Tom Marfiak, who taught me these very characteristics. And I owe a debt of gratitude to these guys because they imbued in me at a young age when I was a department head how to think independently and operate independently. And it served me well, not only in Melius when I was an independent deployer, but also when I was in Desron 60 and I got sent over to oversee the maritime aspect of the evacuation of Lebanon back in 2006. I remember well reporting in and the mission orders I was given was evacuate Lebanon and don't get anyone killed. That was the sum total of the assignment. And because I had had the tutelage of these guys, I saluted smartly and said, I got it. 15,000, I think, was the number that we took out in about 10 days, and fortunately, no one got killed. Okay, so something that I think we need to continue to talk and foster in our wardrooms, and probably would be the subject of a good article for our new and improved Surface Warfare magazine.